But it's the people who put in the hard work in terms of making these cars that we're really interested in. And what I want David to do... Hi, how's
it going? Actually, I know what you're going to ask me to do, but may I just jump in? Rather than me try and explain the difference between these two cars, we've got Tim Goss here, who's been involved in the design of the McLaren car. So, Tim, if you wouldn't mind, these are both winning cars in Formula One. There's a microphone. Thanks, David. Stage is yours. Without getting into too much detail, because, of course, I understand all of that technical aerodynamic stuff, but if you can explain, to me, who doesn't understand, these are two winning cars, but what makes them, you know, the concepts are slightly different if you look at them in terms of styling, but what would you pick out and point to so the camera can see are the key areas of the cars?
I think, I mean, obviously, there's some stuff that's that becomes immediately obvious. I mean, if you look at the way we treated the bodywork, then we elected to go for this U-shaped side pod, which you can see further back. So our approach to trying to feed the rear of the car, rear our main plane especially, is to go for these valleys down the side of the car. If you look at the Red Bull by contrast, then obviously the rear end of their car is sucked down very very tightly and dramatically at the back, and they're obviously taking a slightly different approach to the way they try and drive the rear end. Similarly, if you look at cooling concepts as well, cooling exits, then Red Bull aim to dump all of their cooling air over the top of the rear lower main plane. In other words, just trying to keep the lower surfaces very clean. Again, just to drive the rear lower main plane really hard. For ourselves, then we aim to keep the top body a little bit narrower there and dump some of the cooling air a little bit lower down through the coke. Moving forward to the front of the car, then obviously Red Bull go for a slightly higher nose, slightly different treatment underneath the nose box and the chassis as well. So Red Bull have these turning vanes underneath the chassis. For ourselves, we're achieving a very similar thing, but with what we call a nose splitter at the front of the car. So underneath the nose, we've got this sort of wing platform that sits there. So they're different approaches to the way we're trying to manage the airflow and vortices going down the car. And you pick a solution and you tend to work with it and optimize it further. You know, if we were just to suddenly take something off a Red Bull car and stick it on our car, then it just wouldn't work immediately. You've got to spend some time pressing on with it and just sticking with a particular solution and optimizing it.
Well, that's great stuff for you to point those aspects out. I asked Ross Brawn earlier this year, what aspect of the Mercedes is he proud of? It's not a winning car right now, but there must be some design element of the car that he goes, you know what, we've really aced it there. So this car is a winning car. It hasn't won the championship. But what area of this car would you say we are really proud of this back at our design?
We're very, very proud of a lot of it, to be honest. We do work very hard to pick the areas that we think are going to deliver most performance. It's one of my jobs is to direct everyone to pick the 1, 2, 3 areas that are going to give us most value for money. Yeah, there's traditional areas, obviously, front wing, you're always going to be working hard on front wing. And quite clearly this season, then the back end of the car has been immensely performant. So, just working around the rear corner and exhaust solutions.
Tim, I was there when this car was launched in Germany at the start of this season, and when people saw the side pods, there was an audible gasp from everybody. Now that the year is almost through, can you explain to us what has been the biggest success on this car and perhaps the area that hasn't delivered quite what you were expecting, and maybe now is the time to look back and say, if we'd done that or hadn't done this, we perhaps could have won.
We're immensely critical of ourselves. I mean, us engineers are always being accused of being extremely negative. Yeah. But, what we do is we're always picking out areas where we can improve on the car. If we say, where are we proud of the car, then, we're proud of the work that we've done in developing the car over the season. I mean, in winter testing, clearly it wasn't the quickest car out of the box, but we work extremely hard to work out where we've gone wrong, what we can improve on the car, and we turned it round for Australia. Obviously, we gave Red Bull a head start, and we fully intend to rectify that next year. We're proud of the car. We're proud of the way we've developed it over the year. We've obviously spent a lot of time working on the rear end, spent a lot of time with Mercedes high performance engines developing the engine. and overall the package is now quick. I mean, we're the quickest car all the way through the Japanese Grand Prix weekend. We're pretty much quickest all the way through until race day here today. So,
but how does that happen, Tim? How do you clearly know how to fix your car very quickly? So there's a disconnect very early on in the season or in the winter process that where it goes horribly wrong. We've seen it for 2 or 3 years. Sometimes you come out with a stormer, but traditionally in the last few years,
I mean, I think if we look back at this season, we recognised where the performance was going to be. We picked a solution. In truth, what we were trying to do, we'd picked the right area. We were just a bit too ambitious. We realised that in winter testing and made a sudden change of direction. And I think the problem was that just gave Red Bull a little bit of a head start.
So Ferrari are saying we need to be more ambitious and more creative. Are you maybe saying let's temper just how ambitious we are at the start of the season?
No. I think if you look at this season, I mean, you could look at the Red Bull and say that it's a conservative car. It's not. They're ambitious and they push things really hard. Okay. You've always got to get that balance right. You know, you've got to get that risk-performance balance right. And to be honest, you're not going to produce a championship-winning car unless you push the boundaries a bit.
We're running out of time on this phase of the programme, but you've got to lower the nose for next year and the exhausts are going to be out somewhere not underneath the car. Do you think the car should be ever closer next year? Something I said in commentary, but is that how you see it, that evolution should bring the cars even closer together?
It usually does, yeah. I mean, usually if the rules are a bit more stable, then it does tend to bring the cars closer together. But there's three teams at the moment that are out there in front. I think next season you'd probably suspect that the usual suspects, ourselves, Red Bull, Ferrari and Mercedes GP will do a good job, and Renault could easily spring a surprise on us as well.
Okay, I'm feeling like this is an interview almost. Yes, you've got the job. Congratulations, Mr. Goss. We'll employ you for next season to design the BBC car. I'll take your microphone from you, though, and you can continue to admire all of your hard work and all your effort. How many hours on that car?
Too many.
Far too many. All right, thank you very much, Tim. Well done.